Welcome everyone to the Ontario Caregiver Organization's webinar series. These webinars bring together caregivers and subject matter experts to explore topics of interest to caregivers. We do this to support and engage chosen family, friends, neighbors, really anyone who is caring for someone else. My name is Katie Muirhead, and I'm going to be your moderator for today. Before we begin, I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge the lands that we're on today. And while we meet on a virtual platform with people joining us from across the province, I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge the importance of the land we each call home. I'm joining you today from the city of St. Catharines in the Niagara region, which is the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee and Anishinaabe peoples. This territory is covered by the Upper Canada Treaties and is within the land protected by the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Agreement. Today, this gathering place is home to many First Nations, Métis, and Inuit peoples, and acknowledging this reminds us that our great standard of living is directly related to the resources and friendships of Indigenous peoples. If you'd like to learn more about the lands that you're joining from, you can find more information at native-land.ca. Our webinar today is called Managing Your Mental Health While Navigating the Healthcare System. Ontario's healthcare system is complex and may be difficult for many to navigate. These challenges are often profound for patients, but they also present significant stressors for caregivers and greatly add to the strain on their mental health. In this webinar, we're joined by Stephanie Muskat, a social worker and mental health practitioner, to talk to us about recognizing caregivers' frustration and stressors in navigating the healthcare system, sharing real-life caregivers' experiences and their practical solutions, and of course, some resources and tools to ease navigation challenges. Stephanie is a social worker and mental health practitioner for caregivers in private practice. She has 15 years of experience working as an inpatient social worker at several renowned Toronto hospitals, where she's also conducted various mental health research projects. She works with clients and their caregivers who experience a multitude of health concerns as they navigate a rapidly changing life and environment. And Stephanie also brings personal caregiving experience for her family to the conversation today and understands the true life complexities and challenges of navigating the healthcare system. So welcome, Stephanie.
Thank you so much for having me. It's a true pleasure to be here. And thank you for all your time in being here today. I know that it's not so easy to find the time to be here. So thank you. And so as Katie said, today we're going to be talking about managing your mental health while navigating the healthcare system. And that was such a wonderful introduction. I appreciate it. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about me and my background because I have personal caregiving experience in addition to what Katie mentioned. So when I was 19 years old, my mom was diagnosed with frontotemporal dementia, and the supports that were available, the resources that were available were not what they are today. And I'm so elated to see all of what's available, including from the OCO. It's fantastic. And this webinar series. But I was very lost at that time. I didn't know what to do. I couldn't find supports for myself. And I was navigating the healthcare system to provide my mom support, to try and advocate, get a diagnosis even prior to that. And so it was then that I realized there were significant gaps. And then having worked in the healthcare system myself for 15 years, over 15 years now, I saw that a lot of my patients, a lot of the caregivers of those who were in my units were also struggling. And I realized something had to change, which is why I have created the mental health organization that I now work for. And that's where I'm bringing you all of my information from. I work with a lot of caregivers over time. Everyone has a different circumstance and everyone has someone different that they are caring for in a different scenario. So I'm going to try and include as many as possible today. We'll be going through some real life scenarios at the end so we can take all of our information and put it together. So before we get into the presentation, it's really important that we understand what our healthcare system is like so that we can further than apply what I'm about to talk about to our healthcare system. So if you've ever used our healthcare system, you would know that it is patient-centered in its focus, meaning that they primarily focus on the person who is being taken care of or who is in the hospital, and perhaps not the caregiver, although that is changing in certain areas, which we'll talk about a bit later. There's a short stay approach in hospital. So if someone is admitted, as soon as they no longer need acute care, the push is to go home. And the push is to stay at home and to return home. And at times, again, as I mentioned, there can be limited inclusion and engagement with the caregiver, which we will talk about. So I'm going to go through two common scenarios. One is an outpatient scenario, so someone who's not admitted in the hospital system, and one is an inpatient scenario, which may seem familiar to you, but going through this, you'll see how the caregiver may be going through things and where an issue may begin. And I'm not blaming any practitioner in this. I was also a worker in the system, so I understand there are limitations. But essentially, the person that is receiving care needs to see a doctor or a practitioner. This is an outpatient scenario. So the caregiver may advocate and make a lot of phone calls to make this happen. I just went through this with my daughter. So I care for my little kids as well. And what happens is that when an appointment is made, oftentimes depending on the diagnosis and the circumstances and the cognitive presentation of the person that is being cared for, the caregiver is left out of the conversation in a lot of situations. And so what ultimately results is that the caregiver leaves the appointment not really getting all the answers they had hoped for, maybe not knowing what a plan is in place, not knowing what a medication regimen might be. They might be feeling really frustrated and in the dark, and they may have had questions that may not have been answered. Sometimes a caregiver will go into a medical office and think, okay, the person I'm caring for is going to go in. They're going to talk to the doctor, and then I'm going to have an experience after, or whatever practitioner it might be, to speak to them and talk about things, maybe in private, maybe with them present. And oftentimes they're not given that opportunity. And then the appointment's done, and that's it. And if you want to have those conversations after the fact, you have to start calling again. So this raises significant concerns for the caregiver, which we're going to talk about in a minute, and also the care recipient. This is the inpatient scenario. So this is when someone is admitted to hospital. A patient might have to go to the ER. So this might be the person that is receiving care. And this might result in a few scenarios. And I'm not going to go into too much detail, but just to show the nuances of this, the person who's receiving care may either be admitted to hospital, return home with or without supports directly from the ER, or go to an alternative level of care. And then this proceeds from there. And what can often happen when someone is admitted to the hospital is the caregiver isn't with them all of the time. And so if you've ever been through this, physicians and different team members come by at different times throughout a hospital admission, and the caregiver either feels they have to be there the entire day, which is extremely taxing and oftentimes very not possible in many circumstances. And if they're not there, they're missing information, right? Because whoever's coming by might speak to the person receiving care directly. You may not get phone calls. A lot of times, you know, you aren't getting phone calls. There isn't the ability for the healthcare providers to call every single time. And so a lot of information may not be present. But what can also happen is that a lot of background information might be missing for the healthcare workers because of that gap. And all of a sudden, you may get a phone call that it's time for the person to come home, or a shift has to happen, or a unit change, or even a location change happens. And this is also very, very stressful for the caregiver. So as you can see, both outpatient and inpatient, while not describing all of the scenarios possible, can be really, really taxing. So we talk about impact on the caregiver, and this is significant in this scenario. So it can result in uncertainty, loss of trust in the system. If you've gone through this once, even twice, you might not trust whoever you're working with and your providers, but you also may not feel as though you're going to have a positive outcome, which is really a loss because these are the people that you're working with. These are the people that you want to be part of your team that are supporting you and the person that you're caring for. And with an increased level of stress, not knowing maybe what the care plan might be, not having your questions answered, getting voicemail after voicemail at a doctor's office, not being able to speak to someone, it can result in ultimate burnout as you are navigating the system, finding it difficult to cope. And there are a lot of financial implications as well, because if you're taking time off to be in the hospital all the time, you're really stressed calling doctors, making appointments, trying to follow up. That's taking time away from work. But also, if you're trying to find respite care in the meantime, maybe you're paying for private services. There's a whole spectrum that can impact you from a financial perspective. And what ends up happening over time is all of this builds up on top of each other. And this is just the natural way of navigating the system. We're not even talking about things that can precipitate mental health issues, which further add to the overwhelm. But we can't forget about the impact on the care recipient too, right? Because the care recipient is oftentimes relying on the caregiver and the system to navigate, to figure things out, right? They often need the caregiver. And when the caregiver is burnt out, when the caregiver is overwhelmed, when the caregiver doesn't have an understanding or is left out in the dark, it can really cause a rupture in the relationship between the caregiver and the care recipient. Maybe the caregiver is getting really angry, right? Not having that same dynamic, is snapping, also not knowing what a trajectory might look like. Maybe they don't know what medications are for what, when they need to be given. They're confused. This can also lead to additional ER visits, which can happen in literature. We see when there is burnout in the caregiver too. So it does have a significant impact on hospital admissions, the quality of care received, and as I said, the impact on the relationship with the caregiver. So it is dual. It's not just one-sided. And when the care recipient isn't receiving the care that they need, they may then put it back on the caregiver, and then it becomes this back and forth dynamic. So there are things we can start to do to prepare to mitigate some of the emotional burden that we can experience while navigating our healthcare system. And these are things that even if you're going through it right now or you're not in an acute crisis, I would recommend to start doing because it's always better to plan and prepare ahead of time than when if something is happening in the moment, to try and figure all of the pieces out together is really, really hard. So when I'm working with clients, both from an inpatient and outpatient perspective, I always talk about these things to keep top of mind, whether you're in a situation or not. The first thing is advanced care planning. You may have heard of this before. And essentially, if you're able to speak to the person you're caring for about what their wishes may be in terms of where they might want to live, what they might want to happen if they're admitted to hospital under certain circumstances, it really reduces the burden and the stress of the caregiver when they're in these situations. Because, for example, if you are not sure if the person you're caring for would have wanted to stay home, maybe they preferred a facility, now you're trying to make those decisions in the acute moment on their behalf. I understand not everyone is able to talk to the person that they're caring for due to a cognitive decline or other medical illness. This is what happened between me and my mom. So thinking about specifically who they were can be really helpful. And there are a lot of public available pamphlets online, which we can get sent to you after this, where you can go through this advanced care planning. And it's really a step-by-step process. A lot of hospitals and doctor's offices also offer this as a guide. I do recommend also, if you know that you may be looking at long-term care or retirement facilities later on, take a look right now at what's available in your area. Get some tours, take a list, and have it with you so that, again, if you're in an acute issue, you know where you can look and you're not having to tour things in a day or two because that can be the turnover that a hospital is giving you. You have one day, you have 2 days to go somewhere to get some care for them to, as an intermediary. So having those at the top of your mind are really helpful. And it's good to assess and know your current limits right now. And I'll talk about this a bit more later on, but that includes emotionally, but also physically and financially. If you have to do a lot of heavy lifting all of a sudden and a lot of legwork, and you're not in a situation to do that, it's really good to identify that now, because if you have limitations and you're not able to do those things, it will cause a decline in you, right? We know there's a big connection between mental and physical, and those two interplay, and you have to be okay as a caregiver to provide care. And of course, our financial limitations, know what's possible and what's not. Planning a support network. This one is complicated because a lot of people will come to me and say, I don't have anybody else. There is nobody else I can tap into. And I can appreciate that. On the outset, we can look around and think, no one's coming forward. There's no one I can call upon. Maybe no one lives here. There is this web map that's been created for caregivers specifically to start looking at who is around them in their network through a company called Atlas of Caregiving. We will also send that to you. And I'm actually running a webinar later on for caregivers and also practitioners to look at how to navigate your support network to see who is actually there. Who are you providing care for, but who's providing care for you too? And who can you tap into? And it really helps you look outside of the box. And then having communication strategies with your healthcare team, knowing who to go to when something arises. For example, before you go into a doctor's appointment with the person you're caring for, can you maybe create a handout for the secretary to provide to the doctor or whoever else is on the medical team, giving a summary of the diagnosis or what the presenting issues are, what you were hoping to get through. Maybe let the person at the front desk know, I'm really hoping to speak to this person ahead of time, or maybe after the appointment, because I have questions. So they know it's not just about speaking to the care recipient, because they won't know otherwise. If someone is admitted inpatient, who can you speak to? Usually the charge nurse is a really good resource. The social worker is a really good resource. And the PAA, the person who sits at the front, is an excellent resource. People don't know that. So trying to figure out, okay, who is my point person? Who can I tell things to beforehand so we're not scrambling after and I'm left in the dark? And then knowing what mental health supports are out there if you really need it. And I'm going to speak about that as well. So we talked about what can happen as you're navigating the healthcare system, and I also want to identify and normalize the many emotions of caregiving. Some of these you may have not heard of before and didn't know were part of the process, but they're very real, and they're real with almost every single person I work with. One of those is grief, and we're not talking about grief when someone dies. We're talking about the loss of the person you once knew, the person that maybe you had a relationship with that you're caring for, the loss of what your life once looked like, what you were hoping that it would look like. All of that is real grief. We're talking about anxiety, the stress, the nervousness, what's going to come next, what unpredictable things are out of my control, right? That leads to a lot of anxiety. The guilt of not being able to do exactly what you were hoping for the person you're caring for. The guilt of not being there for other people. Maybe you have children or other people that you care for and you can't give them as much time as you really wanted to. Being a caregiver is significantly overwhelming. I can't even begin to describe the feelings that you may feel and the list of things on your head and the things that are coming to you every single minute of every single day. And then sadness. And I'm not meaning the deep depression you might think of, but just being sad, feeling upset, not recognizing the person in front of you, having to do all of these things you didn't anticipate. These are real emotions in caregiving. So as we start to navigate the process, there's two things that I always work with my clients on from the beginning that really help us when we're managing the healthcare system and managing our mental health. There's this word called self-care that a lot of people don't like because they think it automatically means I have to go to a spa, I have to get my nails done, I have to do all of these things that I don't have the time, the money, the energy for. Who is going to watch this person I'm caring for? And they completely discount this concept of self-care. When I'm talking about self-care, I mean doing things for you that bring you joy and that fill your cup. Because if we have a water bottle like this, for example, you can't keep adding water over and over again. It's going to overflow. You need to make space to add water and empty some of what's there so that you can continue to be balanced in your day. Because what happens is when you keep adding more, you burn out. So what am I talking about when I say self-care? Self-care to me is what are things that you enjoy that you may have to already do already? For example, do you have a coffee machine? Can you make coffee in the morning? Instead of staring at your phone and distracting yourself during that, can we pay attention to the process of making our coffee, smell it, listen to the coffee machine? I've heard from so many people that just that does wonders for them. And actually sitting down and enjoying that cup of coffee, it takes 10 minutes. That's all it takes. And you're doing it anyway. Or having a meal. Can you get some dishes that you really like while the person you're caring for is maybe distracted, watching TV, or sleeping so that you can enjoy your meal? You're doing that anyway. Getting outdoors without distractions. You'll hear me a lot saying distractions because we tend, especially in our society, to be glued to our devices and we're distracting ourselves a lot with input. And a lot of that is not helpful for us. So can we remove our distraction, go outside, listen to what's happening outside? You know, are there birds chirping? Can you go outside with the person that you're caring for? Take them for a walk, even if they're in a wheelchair or assisted device. Can they go with you? You're doing that anyway. So thinking about self-care in another way is important as you're navigating this because we can't leave our entire selves behind. And a lot of people do. And then the second thing I want to point out is boundaries. Start to think about what phone calls can I answer? What phone calls do I have the time to navigate? What events can I do? What events can I can't do? How much texting can I do? Knowing your limitations and starting to identify what I call your internal thermometer, right? So are you at 40 degrees? Are you at 60 degrees? You want to be at 20 degrees. So what do you need to do to get that in check? And this is a process, right? It's not easy, but starting to think about self-care and boundaries is really important. So with this, there are extremes in every situation, and extremes are normal because, again, as we add up, if we don't mitigate what we're adding to our cup, it can spill over, that is a lot of stress. So there may be a time when additional supports may be needed, and these are some signs I want you to look out for. So difficulty getting through your day, not looking forward to the future, anxiety that overtakes you and is very overwhelming, feeling sad or weepy all day or for weeks at a time, having difficulty sleeping or getting out of bed, and thoughts of harming yourself or others. You would be surprised how common these are because, again, you are extremely overwhelmed and you are not going to get in trouble. This is a really hard process, and actually you're not weak if you seek help. It actually takes a lot of strength to seek help, and it's going to help you be a better caregiver long term and also help your care recipient. So just be aware of what you're going through. And if these come up, you might want to seek some professional support immediately. So I want to talk about supports in general, not just specifically when you see those things arising, but maybe when you're looking for additional help, right? You're going through this, you're feeling really lonely, very isolated. There are public and private supports to look out for. We're going to send you links to these after. Public supports are wonderful. Again, there's so many more available now than when I was going through this, and I am so happy to see that, and such a variety too. There are pros and cons. They can be more time limited. They can have wait lists. Perhaps they're not as custom to you, but they're still excellent, and there's so many available right now. Some of those include from Baycrest. Baycrest has this great program, Baycrest at Home. They have caregiver supports. Wellspring has cancer supports. Wellspring is an organization that provides mental health supports and others. The OCO, where you are right now, has so many supports. And the Reitman Center at Mount Sinai, which is in Toronto. If we talk about private supports, they may have more availability more immediately, and they may be more long-term and more custom, but they can be really expensive. Some do take on private insurance coverage, and so depending who you're working with, you can get private insurance. And you will want to look for a caregiver therapist if it is caregiver stuff that you're dealing with, possibly a social worker that knows the system, because the system has a lot to do with the mental health concerns of caregivers. 60% of my clients come to see me not because of their caregiving, but because of navigating the system. So you want someone who knows the system, and look at a therapist support site, which has a lot of therapists on it, such as Psychology Today. Specific caregiver therapists are definitely out there. They're more limited, but you can find them for sure. And just so you know, the most important predictor of therapy is not actually the knowledge that a caregiver therapist has or a general therapist, but it's the alliance and the relationship. So look for someone that you get along with, that you feel a connection to. That is the most important predictor in the research. Things that we don't think about. Instagram, if you use it, has a ton of supports. A lot of people are posting about caregivers, about different diagnoses, about different complexities, whether you're caring for a child, a sibling, an aunt, a parent. So much is out there on Instagram, so much free information. There are Facebook groups, a lot of them available, where you can speak to other people around the clock going through the same situations as you. Podcasts. So I have a podcast. It's free, called Caregiver's Compass. It is a podcast that talks about mental health of caregiving. We have a lot of different guests on. I talk about my personal experiences as well. And there are other podcasts I'm happy to share that talk about caregiving, right? We're all doing things around the house. Podcasts are excellent. And then there are webinars and workshops available online. Again, the OCO has so many of them. We have so many available all throughout the web that you can take a look at. Do a quick Google search. You would be so surprised at what you can find. So I want to bring this all together for real case scenarios. These are case scenarios that I did alter a little bit because I don't want anyone to ever be singled out. I have to always make sure that it's non-identifiable. But these are real scenarios, and it takes everything I'm saying into consideration so that you can see how someone went from point A to point B, and that hope is possible, because I can tell you, hope is absolutely possible. I see positive outcomes all the time. Nothing is perfect, but positive outcomes happen all the time, and I've seen it for years. So I have three scenarios to go through with you to apply what we talked about. Scenario number one, this was a client who had four adult children, one with significant disabilities requiring constant care and supervision at home. The extended family of my client lived elsewhere, and he and his wife navigated all of their children alone while they managed full-time work, and they both worked multiple jobs. My client came to me and experienced significant panic attacks. So what that means is that they were feeling a lot of shaking and tremors, increased heart rate, increased breath, some tingling in their fingers. They were overeating because they didn't know how to cope with the emotions and what was going on with them that they were experiencing. And they reached out to me for support. So what we soon found out after doing an initial assessment is that the client was experiencing significant difficulty navigating the system and finding supports for his son, who had a rare genetic disease. He would find that he would go to one clinic and they would give him a few things, and then he didn't know where to go, and he would try to call a different office. Getting a diagnosis was incredibly hard, and they didn't trust the system. They didn't trust medical clinicians anymore. His son was also admitted to hospital many times and was discharged home with minimal supports. And as you can imagine, navigating three other children and also having to work and take care of their son full time was extremely overwhelming. So they ended up hiring private care, but it was extremely costly because 24/7 care was needed, and the parents were working several jobs and had a lot of other things going on. So this person was very overwhelmed. So we worked together through several items. One was on boundaries, because there were a lot of added tasks my client was taking on that he didn't need to. There were friends calling and saying, come and see me, you know, twice a week. Which we decided was maybe too much in the moment. So how could we work to shift this and shift what was going on so that he could focus on the task at hand, but also his personal self, right? We talked about self-care, and that was really important. Looking at what was required and what he could say no to, even in a work environment, right? Not going after work every single day, making his employer know what was going on so that his employer was aware, oh, okay, you might not be able to stay for that extra meeting. He maximized care from our healthcare system. So he used public supports to supplement the private supports that he was using before, which he didn't know about. And by doing that, he was able to reduce the costs when possible with the public supports. And then he shifted his expectations of self because he had this idea he had to do everything on his own. There was a lot of ingrained guilt and shame there from his childhood. And a lot of things come up in our work with caregivers that have nothing to do with the caregiving. So we shifted the expectations of what he thought he had to do to maybe what was more realistic. Scenario two, a client's mom lives with the client's father. Her mother has a fall, and all of a sudden her cognitive state takes a downturn, and there were no pre-existing health conditions. So this came out of the blue. They had never managed her mom's health before, and she had no idea what to do. So she took her mom to the hospital, and it was determined that her mother had a stroke and a broken limb. She was admitted to hospital, and unfortunately, the staff was not fully aware of the home situation, what was happening. Her father could not take care of her mother. He was elderly himself, and my client was an only child and was navigating her own life. So a few days later, despite functional deficits and a decline, which the healthcare team did not know, my client suddenly received a call that her mom was going to be discharged home the next day because she was medically stable, meaning the stroke was an acute stroke. It wasn't continuing to bleed. And although there was a broken limb, it could be managed for at home. So my client was extremely stressed, as you can imagine, because again, her mom lived with her elderly father and my client couldn't move in and just take care of her. She had several children of her own job and her own life. And she had no idea who was going to care for her mom at home. And suddenly she's been faced with, you have a day to get your mom home. And she was really panicking. So we went through some communication strategies, which is what I noted on earlier. There's something you can do in an inpatient setting called a family team meeting. And what you can do in this situation is actually meet with the team as a whole. So you're talking physiotherapist, occupational therapist, doctor, pharmacist, social worker. To talk to all of them in one place, to raise your concerns, talk about what a baseline might have looked like before a hospital admission, let them know what the realities are and what might not be feasible and possible at this time. Again, being a caregiver requires a significant amount of advocacy. It's exhausting, but she knew that it was just not feasible for her mom to come home. She'd end up right back in the ER, plus her dad could have been injured. So she also noted her personal limits and inabilities and her concerns for her mom's safety. Now, of course, the hospital isn't going to say, sure, we'll keep them for 3 weeks, right? That they can't do that. It's very high turnover. There's a lot of people waiting in the ER. I'm sure you hear about that all the time. People that have to come from other units and they need beds. But raising these concerns can foster alternative treatment options, maybe additional supports at home that weren't thought of in the past, and maybe spike more of a conversation with the team and the family. And before we go to scenario three, I just want to let you know what happened here. So they weren't aware of the mom's baseline. And what happened is they decided to apply to a rehab facility because her cognitive deficits weren't as intense inpatient. So she had them at home when she had the stroke, but she was actually okay. It was her physical state that was really impacted. So they decided to apply to a rehab center so her mom could rehab there. And her mom ended up coming home and actually ending up functioning and rehabilitating further at home with additional public supports from our community. And that was it was an excellent result for the client and for her family member. So scenario three, a client's sister has a significant mental health issue that is fluctuating, meaning sometimes she's okay and she presents as normal. Again, what is normal, but normal for her. And then sometimes she is not okay and she poses a significant safety risk to herself. She also needs assistance taking her medication. So she needs the medication to stay stable, but she doesn't remember or she just doesn't know where her medication is. and she needs help with bathing and dressing herself, and she also lives alone. So my client was called frequently by the police or neighbors, noting that her sister had been found outside, she was acting out, she was not taking redirection, and oftentimes she had to be brought back home by my client or taken to my client's home for assistance and monitoring. Now, my client did not have a good relationship with her sister. There was a lot of stuff from before. She had a brother, but he didn't live in the country. And she was the only contact listed. So, of course, the police didn't know who else to call. She was the only person who was at their fingertips. And she was the one that was being called all the time. So, of course, in this situation, my client was really left with not knowing what to do. She was being forced to go and either spend extended periods of time with her sister, caring for her when she had her own stuff to do, and she either had to bring her sister into her own home or navigate going back and forth. And that was really, really complicated for her and causing a lot of stress, not to mention the significant burden. I don't know if you've had this, where you're getting called and you're like, oh my God, who's calling me now? What's happening now? That anxiety response when you're getting phone calls, you know, it's significant. We can't ignore that. And it was a big, really big piece for her. So what did we do? We made a communication plan and we started to explore her boundaries. And she realized very quickly, she can't be the only one to answer the phone calls to the police. And she can't answer the phone calls from the police all the time or healthcare workers. So we had to create a care map, like I talked about earlier, to see who else was in her environment, who else she could tap into for supports. She realized that she had a neighbor that was willing to help out. She did have to give them a call. And she realized that there was actually a friend she hadn't spoken to in many years who was actually okay with taking on some of the responsibilities. So after doing some of this care map work and exploring her social supports, she saw that she needed to tap into other people. She ended up finding a local day program through the work of a community social worker, and she found a physician who was willing to help manage and titer the medication ongoing because clearly her sister was not stable. They put in several supports through home and community care support services. Now it's a different name, but it's what used to be called CCAC or the LIN to help her sister with her medication every single day. So they would come in and remind her and help her take it. And this also helped manage her mental health. A lot of emotions were raised due to the complexities of her relationship with her sister growing up and from the past, and she decided to seek her own mental health support and found a public support group that looked at siblings and navigating relationships with siblings who have their own mental health concerns. Again, perfection was not attainable. She was still getting calls from police and healthcare workers ongoing, but it was a lot better. And that's the point, is that we always work as things are fluctuating to get places that are manageable. It's never going to be perfect, and that's not an expectation, but how can we make these situations better so we're not drowning and we're not insanely overwhelmed? So I know I threw a lot of information at you right there. And of course, as I said, every situation is different. But as you can see, there's things you can do in advance to try and mitigate issues in a crisis, to try and know what's going on ahead of time. There's things you can plan out for. And then if you're really struggling, there are a lot of avenues that you can seek for support in the meantime. So now we're going to take it to questions. I know I see there's a lot of questions in the chat. I think someone has raised their hand. Thank you for listening. Honestly, I truly appreciate your time. And now we'll get to the Q&A.
Great. Thank you so much, Stephanie. That was fabulous. All wonderful tips and strategies to get all of our minds going. We can go ahead and pull down the slides now, stop sharing those slides, and see if there's any questions from all of you. So we've had some great resources shared in our chat box, some wonderful comments, but this is the time, folks. If you do have questions for Stephanie, please, please, please write them into the chat box. I noticed someone did raise their hand. If you want to type your question or comment into the chat, that we can get to it here. Great comment just now. That was the most excellent presentation, and you did a great summary of the system and the issues caregivers face. It's a lot to summarize in a really short amount of time, given all of our experiences of caregiving are so very different. what happens in Toronto is not the same as what happens in Northern Ontario or rural communities in Southern Ontario. So it's very diverse. You mentioned in one of your scenarios, this notion of trust and trusting systems and the folks that we're working alongside as caregivers. And I know in my experience, we hear often that caregivers can sometimes struggle with that. They might have difficult interactions with healthcare professionals or even community service providers. And I wonder if you have any more tips or recommendations for caregivers who might need to work with that organization or that hospital or community group, but are really struggling with building that relationship and trust.
Yeah, that's a really good question. So usually when trust is broken, we have to make some effort to try and communicate, to try and foster a different relationship. We can't choose different providers and different people all the time, especially when we're dealing with specializations or we're in a hospital system. But sometimes there is a miscommunication and a disconnect. So I know it's hard as caregivers. We're so fueled. We have so much emotion with us. But to actually come forward and say, you know what, I'm feeling like maybe we're not on the same page here. You know, I'm feeling like I'm losing some trust and I don't want to feel that way because I know it's not the fault of you, right? Taking that burden and not maybe blaming, but saying, I don't understand. Can we have a conversation and try to understand each other? I find a lot of time practitioners do not know that caregivers and other people are feeling those ways because they're just going through what they have to do. So try and foster some sort of communication. And if you're feeling like you're too overwhelmed as caregivers, maybe seeing, is there somebody else that maybe can take the reins and be a mediator? Having a mediator is really helpful at times, especially when they're not as emotionally fueled. So I would say try and have a conversation. It leads to a lot of positive outcomes for sure.
That's a great tip. And I really appreciated your comment around care mapping and being able to find ways to delegate to other folks because not everyone is a born advocate or a strong communicator. And sometimes that's not there where they sit comfortably, but they might have a sibling or someone else who can take on that role within, you know, the context of caregiving. So delegation can be so important for so many reasons as a caregiver, for sure. Another great comment in the chat about how validating this session was for them. And we've had a couple comments around relationship dynamics. And so you even mentioned in your scenario, some different relationship dynamics, siblings versus parents versus spouses, and you know, some of the challenges that can come with that, where, you know, I know for me, caring for a parent is more complicated because of those relationship dynamics versus a sibling or a partner. And I don't know if you have any experience or strategies for folks when maybe they need to communicate or take on more of that advocacy role when they're navigating those complicated family or caregiving relationships.
Yeah. So something that I would say is helpful. Not everyone is so comfortable doing it off the bat, but writing an email can be so, it's so simple, really, in theory, but noting down, you know, here is what's happening and here is what I really need your help with right now. Delegating in that manner, you may not have a relationship with some family members, or maybe you're feeling like they've really let you down and they're not present, or they just have disappeared, which again, I hear all the time. So just writing an email and saying, hey, everybody, right? Put everyone there. This is what I need. This is what's going on. Can someone please step forward and do A, B, C, D? So it doesn't matter who exactly is coming forward or not, because a lot of people won't, but a lot of people will. And a lot of people don't know what's happening. And I find in those situations, when you're actually delegating and saying what exactly you need, people do come forward. Because otherwise, people don't know what to do. They don't want to rock the boat. So I would say send an email, send a text message to a group, right? I know it seems really vulnerable and hard, but you really need support. And sometimes in those moments, you can't care, right? You'll deal with it later.
And just a quick follow-up to that, how would you support a caregiver were they to do something like that and not get the response that they were maybe looking for, where maybe they thought, all those friends and family that came knocking and offering casseroles and food and well wishes and let me know how I can help. And then they do that vulnerable thing, and those folks don't necessarily reciprocate. Do you have any thoughts or comments on that?
Yeah, so I mean that's inevitable. People, I'll say people will come forward in some capacity when you're sending an email, but it may not be all of the people that you were hoping for. And that's when I also said if you're feeling really alone and isolated and by yourself, doing that care map, we'll send a link afterwards. I know someone had asked about that too. But there is an exercise where you can create a whole map of who's in your support system. And there might be someone you hadn't thought about that's not in your immediate family. That's not someone that maybe is a friend that you'd think off the bat. People come through in ways that you wouldn't have imagined that you haven't spoken to in ages. And I see that over and over again with clients. So again, looking at the care map as a resource and also acknowledging you're not by yourself, tapping into those Facebook groups, venting, getting it off your chest, right? This is a really hard experience as it is. Feeling alone in it and feeling like no one's coming forward to support you. And also comparison is huge, right? So looking at all of those avenues too. But trust me, I get it. I've been there too, and I know how that feels, and it's awful.
Yeah, and peer support can be so powerful. Like you say,
Yeah.
accessing those groups, whether it be work that OCO does or community groups through the Alzheimer's Society or informal groups through social media. What I say to folks is it doesn't take away the hard stuff every day, but it does make you feel less alone. And
Yeah.
it does take folks a long time, sometimes, to cross the threshold of accessing the group. We know they exist, we know that they're out there, but there's sometimes, different barriers in terms of getting there. And so it can really make a huge difference. So folks, go out and get some support if you're feeling alone. We have a question that came through the chat around where do I start in getting home care? Which is, something we're going to see more and more and more requests for as we are living in an aging population with folks' needs rising, people wanting to stay at home or in the community. So do you have any thoughts or tips, hacks for our caregivers on,
Yep.
where do we start when it comes to home care?
It's a good question. So there's public home care and there's private home care. And so again, the public, the name keeps changing. So I'm going to refer it to what it was recently, which is home and community care support services. If you Google it, you can still find it. Google home and community care HCCSS. And what they'll have is it'll pop up your postal code. If you put your postal code into that box, it will tell you who your local home and community care access point is. You call them, they will actually refer you to someone who is your coordinator, and that person is the one who is going to be helping you through the process of accessing public community care supports. When it comes to private supports, there are a lot of different agencies out there. You'd have to do your own research. There are some websites that you can take a look at. If you look at your local area, they'll show you what's available, and that's run by the Government of Ontario. I'm happy to send out that link too. It's the local health line, I think it's called. And that way you can see what's available publicly and privately. And that's how I would start.
Yeah, and it's a different experience for everyone across. Many caregivers sort of wait until they feel like it's ultimately needed, and we can access it early on. So the earlier you get engaged with home and community care support services, the better potentially the outcomes might be. And thanks to those putting those acronyms and things in the chat box, we'll send a link out in our post-webinar information. We had a question around and a shared comment around my husband has aphasia, so it's hard during medical appointments. Do you have any tips or strategies when you're supporting somebody with communication challenges or different cognitive impairments? And as a caregiver, how you can support them through those medical appointments?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So a lot of my patients and clients who have had aphasia, They will access the use of an SLP, a speech language pathologist. And again, you can find this through home and community care, or you can do this privately. They will teach you some strategies, if possible, that you can learn to communicate and use with the person you're caring for. Sometimes it has been a whiteboard. Sometimes it's pointing out letters. Sometimes it's other things. So I would highly suggest seeking out the support of an SLP who is really an expert in that avenue, because it is really difficult to navigate for sure.
Stroke networks and stroke groups across the province for folks. Which do provide resourcing and support and information on how to access stroke rehab in an acute or early stage and then in the community as well. I was a caregiver for my grandfather who had a stroke, so I have some understanding of that, and OCO certainly supports a number of those stroke initiatives. So those are great community-based resources that are no cost to folks looking for those kinds of supports and services. Just looking through our questions that are coming in. Thanks to everyone for adding more questions to the chat. And maybe as I scroll through my little list here, I'll ask one that just came through in terms of how do we access social work? So we hear a lot as caregivers that we should seek professional support as well as peer support. And sometimes those publicly funded options aren't as readily available. Do you have any recommendations on accessing counseling or support for caregivers?
Yeah, so there is a website called Psychology Today. Almost every single therapist that I know is on there. So if you go there, you can actually search for specific topics and things that you're needing support for. And one of the things you can put in is caregiver. And that will give you a list of people who have identified that they support caregivers. You will have to go through the list and see who might resonate. Also, again, Google can be your best friend or your worst enemy, but in this case, it can actually also help. So if you Google caregiver therapist or caregiver mental health, and you pop that in, it will show you who actually provides that. I'm also happy. I know a lot of different people out there. So if you can't find somebody, just shoot me a quick email. It will be shared at the end, and I'm happy to share some information from different people depending on where you are and what you're looking for.
Thank you so much. That's great. We will be sharing out the slide deck and the recording and the resources that we're discussing. So folks, we'll all get that into your email. We had someone share a scenario and an experience around caring for an aging mother, but also their child who has mental health issues. And the caregiving and my feelings were so different with the two. So very different experiences in your caregiving world and systems and navigation, but also from an emotional standpoint. And they found this very difficult to navigate what they were feeling when and for who. And so they're asking if you have any suggestions on how to manage, you know, how do we manage two caregiving scenarios all at the same time?
Yeah, and you'd be surprised to know that I see this every single day, whether you're caring for a child and a parent, multiple children and a parent, a sibling, two parents, it happens a lot. And you're right, it is so hard to field this. I would go directly to seeking some sort of professional support, because you have to navigate the different emotions, but also the different complexities going on with one and the other. And I'm sure a lot is coming up. And you also have to piece out, when do I do what in what scenario? And when do I need to do this versus that? And obviously your child is your child, so wanting to focus on them at certain points, it's really hard. So, you know, definitely go to seek some support, I would say.
Absolutely. And everybody's situation is so different, right? So I'm sure all those clients and individuals you supported with complex situations all had their own stories and their own impacts and outcomes as well. We are at time. We've had a lot of wonderful comments and feedback and questions. And if there are some questions we weren't able to get to that we can respond to, we will put those in our post-webinar email as well. So I do want to thank you, Stephanie, for bringing your personal and professional experience to the webinar today and sharing some fabulous practical tips and strategies to support caregivers while navigating the healthcare system. So thank you so much for joining us.
It's been my pleasure. Thank you so much. This has been wonderful.